In this pair of graphs, we're going to look at altered pressure volume loops. Specifically, what we're going to do is look at cardiovascular changes that affect ventricular performance. And to do so, we're going to graph left ventricular pressure versus left ventricular volume. Now, we have a normal loop here shown in red on both sides. And let's just quickly review what's happening during the cardiac cycle from the view of the ventricle, right, through this pressure volume loop. And so we have to jump in at one spot here. So let's jump in right here. And at this spot, our pressure has fallen to the point where the AV valve opens, right? And we know that because we're now moving to the right. Our volume is rising in the ventricle, which means that AV valve is open and we're filling. And we fill passively at first, and then the atria contract and we actively fill at the end of this phase. At that point, the ventricles start to contract and the AV valves would close due to the pressure rising in that ventricle. We become isovolumic, right? When that valve is closed, we're not yet ejecting blood. So pressure rises and rises in the ventricle very quickly until it exceeds the pressure on the other side of the aortic semilunar valve. So that semilunar valve opens right here and our volume starts to fall. We start to go to the left here. And so we're ejecting our stroke volume. We reach a peak systolic pressure. Then pressure starts to fall a little bit as the ventricle begins to relax. Eventually, the pressure will fall to the point at which the aortic pressure is greater than the ventricular pressure, and the semilunar valve will close right here. That stops the ejection phase. We want to become isovolumic. In this case, where pressure is falling as the cardiomyocytes relax, and the pressure will fall and fall until the atrial pressure is once again higher, and our AV valve opens down here. We begin the next cycle. Now, we want to look at two specific examples of cardiovascular changes that can occur to affect ventricular performance. On the left here, we're going to look at preload, an increase in preload. On the right, we're going to look at an increase in afterload. Preload is the degree of stretch of the cardiomyocytes prior to their contraction, prior to stimulating them to contract. And it is determined by their filling. If we recall, this peak ventricular volume down here is EDV, our end diastolic volume. Well, EDV is a measure of our preload. So if we increase EDV, have increased filling of that ventricle, we have now stretched those cardiomyocytes to a greater degree, and we're going to get a Frank-Starling effect. Right? The Frank-Starling effect is a length-tension relationship of those cardiomyocytes. When you stretch them, you optimize the number of cross bridges that will form, and we're going to get an enhanced contraction in response. And so this increased filling that occurs in response to a whole variety of potential factors, a slow heart rate could allow increased filling, longer time for filling. Increased blood volume increases the venous return and increases EDV. During exercise, the muscular pump, the skeletal muscle contracting, drives venous blood flow back to that ventricle. And so we're going to get our isovolumic contraction, but then we're going to get this enhanced contraction that's going to eject a larger stroke volume. If you recall, the area of the pressure volume loop is an indicator of the amount of work performed by that ventricle. And so our increased preload loop in the dashed line here is utilizing more oxygen and doing more work, right, to eject this larger stroke volume. On the right, we have an increase in afterload. Now, afterload is the resistance the ventricle has to overcome to drive blood into the arterial circuits. And hypertension increases that afterload. It does that by increasing the pressure that the ventricle must overcome to open the semilunar valve. And of course, remember, that's happening over here. Our isovolumic contraction is occurring. Normally, our semilunar valve opens here, and we start our ejection phase. But if blood pressure is high, then we have to meet that pressure in the aorta with a stronger ventricular contraction. We spend more time being isovolumic, and therefore less time, possibly, ejecting our blood. And so our stroke volume can actually fall. Again, work is pressure times volume. Pressure being our y-axis here and volume being our x-axis. Well, in the hypertensive case, we're doing more pressure work and less volume work, right? We're moving a slightly smaller stroke volume while doing more pressure work, right? Which again, we want to do as little pressure work as possible. We want to be moving the blood. And so if you look at our loop, our hypertensive loop in the dashed line, the area has increased. We're spending more energy to eject blood when we're hypertensive, even though we're moving a reduced stroke volume. So again, efficiency of the heart can fall. We're making our heart work harder to move the same or even a smaller volume of blood per cardiac cycle.